So in the last class, I explained the logical equivalence concept, right? How to prove whether the given conditional prepositions or composite prepositions are logically equivalent or not using the truth table method. So what you will do using the truth table method, you will construct the truth table for the given compound prepositions and we'll check the resultant column of the both the prepositions. If they are equal, then we can say that they are logically equivalent. Next, other method is the replacement process. So using the replacement process, what you will do, you will take the LHS part, one preposition you will take and you will derive the preposition to get the required preposition, right? If you are able to get the required preposition, then we can say that they are logically equivalent. So to for this derivation, you need to know the replacement laws on conjunction and disjunction and conditional statement and biconditional statement, right? We have already discussed all those rules and I have explained two examples on this also, right? Let me explain one more example. Prove that negation of P double tends to Q, that is the biconditional, negation of the biconditional statement is logically equivalent to P and negation Q or Q and negation P. You need to prove this, right? So first to take this LHS part, negation of P double tends to Q. What is the first step? Whenever you have a biconditional statement and conditional statements in your preposition, first you need to eliminate them. So how to eliminate the biconditional statement? You know the fall. You know the rule, right? P double tends to Q is logically equivalent to P tends to Q and Q tends to P. Right? So using the formula I have applied here, Now you again have a conditional statement. Again you need to remove this. So how to do that? P tends to Q is logically equivalent to, you know that it is equal to negation P or Q, right? So I have applied the same formula here. Then you will get in place of P tends to Q, I can write negation P or Q, and this negation will be the same. Similarly, Q tends to P can be written as negation Q or P. Now you don't have any conditional and biconditional statement. Next, what you have to do? You have to apply the De Morgan's law and distributive law based on the requirement, right? So here you can apply the De Morgan's law. Why? Because you have a negation outside this parenthesis. So just apply the negation to the individual terms. Then you will get negation of the first term. Here you have an AND operation. When you apply the De Morgan's law, this will become an OR operation. And apply a negation to this second term. Again, you can apply the De Morgan's law here, then it becomes negation of negation P, that is your P, and this R becomes AND negation Q. Similarly, the same R operation here, negation of negation Q is Q, and the R becomes AND, P becomes negation P. So when you see this, it is the LHS part, your LHS part, P and negation Q or Q and negation P. So by taking the LHS part, you are able to get the RHS part. Therefore, you can say that given two compound prepositions are logically equivalent. Did you all understand, ma'am? Let us go on to the next example. Prove that P tends to Q tends to P is logically equivalent to negation P tends to P tends to Q. So same thing, ma'am. Take the LHS part, which is P tends to Q tends to P. So first you need to eliminate this conditional statement, right? So it is something like P tends to Q, where your Q is Q tends to P. This is the second term. So it is equal to negation P or Q, right? So negation P or what is your Q here? Your Q is complete Q tends to P. Now again you can apply this same formula here. Q tends to P is equal to negation Q or P. Now it is negation P or, in place of this you can write negation Q or P. Now as these two are same, these two symbols are same, the symbol within the parenthesis, outside the parenthesis are same, then you can apply the associative law, right? So A plus B plus C can be written as A plus B plus C. The same I have written here. Negation P or P or the Q. Right? Negation P or P or negation Q. Now negation P or Q, you know that it is true. True or negation Q. True or something is always true. So after deriving the LHS part, you came to know that it is a tautology. If you prove that the RHS part is also a tautology, then you can say that these two are logically equivalent. So take the RHS part, which is negation P tends to P tends to Q. Right? Same thing, ma. Just apply the, what we call, just remove the conditional statement. So negation P tends to, the P tends to Q can be written as negation P or Q. Now this is your complete Q and this is your P. Again apply the formula, P tends to Q is equal to negation P or Q, and here my P is negation P. So negation P or, what is my Q here? Negation P or Q. Right? Just to simplify this, using the De Morgan's law, negation of negation will become positive. So it becomes P or negation P or Q. Again, apply the associative law. Why? Because within the parenthesis, outside the parenthesis, you have the same symbol. Now it becomes P or negation P or Q. Now you know that this is true or Q. True or something is always true. So the RHS part is also giving you the same result, true value. So both given prepositions are, both are tautologies. Therefore, they are logically equivalent. Is it clear? And see the last example. Prove that negation of P tends to Q is logically equivalent to P or Q and negation of PRQ or negation of PRQ. So the same example we have discussed, ma'am. So the same LHS part we have considered in our previous example. Here we have proved that negation of P double tends to Q is equal to P and Q or Q and negation P. Now here you are asked to prove that negation of P double tends to Q. This is also logically equivalent to P or Q and negation of P and Q. Right? So these are the formulas we have discussed on logical equivalences on biconditional statement that we are proving here. Now take the LHS part, which is negation of P double tends to Q. Same, you know that P double tends to Q can be written as P tends to Q and Q tends to P. Okay. So first, remove this conditional statement. Now in place of this, you can write negation P or Q. In place of this, you can write Q negation Q or P. Now apply the De Morgan's law, then it becomes negation of P and negation Q. This is your first term. Here I have applied the De Morgan's law. Now it becomes negation of negation Q and negation P. Yes, ma'am. Now simplify this. Negation of negation, this becomes P and negation Q or Q and negation P. Right? But here you should get P or Q. So what you can do is you have a different symbol before and after the parenthesis. That means you can apply the distributive law. So when you apply this distributive law, you will get four terms. 1, 1, 1, 2. 2, 1, 2, 2. Like this, total of four terms you will get. First is 1, 1. That is P and Q you will get. 1, 1. Next. And 1, 2. That is P, negation P. 1, 2. Next to 2, 1. Negation Q, Q. 2, 2. Negation Q, negation P. Now, when you simplify this P or Q, the second value will become true because variable and its negation is true. Variable or its negation is true. Similarly, third value is also true. And the last value is negation Q or negation P. So this is something like what we have to get in your LHS part, you should get P or Q. So you got this P or Q and negation of P and Q. But here you have negation Q or negation P. So you apply the De Morgan's law, then it becomes negation of Q and P. Q and P can also be written as P and Q, negation of P and Q. And the first term will be as it is, P or Q. This is your RHS part. So from the LHS part, you can able to derive the RHS part. Therefore, given two compound prepositions are logically equivalent. So did you all understand what is this logical equivalence concept? Yes. Did every one of you understand this, ma? The replacement process. Okay. Okay. Now, let's move on to the concept of normal forms. Next, normal forms. We have two types of normal forms, disjunctive normal form and conjunctive normal forms, right? So, disjunctive normal form. Let us see disjunctive normal form. So, if you have a compound preposition in the form of sum of elementary products, if you have a preposition with a sum of elementary products, the preposition is something like containing sum of elementary products, then we can say that is in DNF, disjunctive normal form. Now we'll see what is the sum of elementary products. Product means it is AND symbol. It is an AND symbol. That means it is a conjunction. So see the examples for elementary products. So we have two variables And we can also have the negation of the variables. But with between the two variables, you should have a conjunction that is known as elementary product. So sum of elementary product means what? You should have elementary products, and between the products you should have a sum. Sum means it is a disjunction. It is a disjunction. What are these? Similarly, elementary sums means, sum means it is a disjunction. So between the variables and the negations, you should have a disjunctive symbol. So sum of elementary products is a DNF form. Sum of elementary products is a DNF form. Let us see one example. The procedure will be the same. Oh, what is the procedure you have followed for replacement process? The same also you can follow here. So whenever you find any, conditional and biconditional statement, first you need to remove them. Second step is you can apply the De Morgan's law, and third step is you have to apply the distributive law. Why? Because here sum of elementary products means what? You should have only the disjunctive symbols and the conjunctive symbols, but not the conditional statement and the biconditional statement. So first you need to eliminate the conditional as well as the biconditional statements. So this is the procedure to be followed. Let's see one example. Obtain a DNF for the preposition P tends to Q, and negation of Q, negation Q or negation Q. What are these? Right? So first step is what? First you need to eliminate the conditional and biconditional statement. First take the given compound preposition, and now eliminate the conditional and biconditional statement. Right? So it is something like P tends to Q. This complete is your Q. So P tends to Q is negation P or Q. So negation P or this is your complete Q. This is your complete Q. Now you simplify this one. Here again you have one more conditional statement. So it is negation P or, in place of this P tends to Q, you can write negation P or Q, right? So, and this remaining will be as it is. So, now you just simplify this. You don't have any conditional and biconditional statement here. So, when you don't have any conditional biconditional statement, you can move to the second step, that is apply the De Morgan's law, right? So, it is negation P or, here you cannot apply the De Morgan's law. Why? Because you don't have any negation of before this, outside this parenthesis, and here you can apply the De Morgan's law. Now it becomes negation of negation Q. It is Q, and R becomes and negation of negation P. That is your P. Okay. Now negation P or now you can apply the distributive law. Right? So, but in your, you first check my in your answer. So here you have, what are the terms you are having? You have a product term. Similarly, you have a sum, right? So this is a product, elementary product. This is an elementary sum. But DNF means what? Sum of elementary products. That means between the terms you should have a sum. But here you have a product, right? So you should have a disjunction between the terms. Just to get the disjunction, what I am doing is I am applying this distributive law, right? So this can be written as negation P and this Q and P as one term. I am treating this as one term. Similarly, or this R symbol I am distributing. I am distributing the R symbol between negation P and Q. Or now Q and P. First variable from the first term, second variable from the first term, and this is the second term. Now you just simplify this one. Negation P and P and Q. So negation P and P becomes what? It is false, because it is a disjunction. True and false is always false. False and something is always false only. Similarly, coming to the second term, this is Q and Q can be written as a single Q and P. P and Q and P, you can also write it as P and Q. So false or something is what? That something only. What is that something? P and Q. So therefore, it can be written as negation P or this P and Q. So when you observe this, this is one term, this is another term. Between the two terms, you have a sum and the term contains a product. So this is an elementary product between the terms. So you have a sum. So you can say that it is a sum of elementary products. It is in the form of sum of elementary products, which is your required BNF form. Is it clear, ma? Let's go through these ones. Just go through this once, ma. I'll be back in 2 minutes. So is it clear for you all how to get the DNF form? See one more example. Obtain a DNF for negation of P tends to Q and F. So the procedure is same, ma. When you have a conditional or biconditional statement, first you remove them. So here it is a conditional statement, right? So this P tends to Q can be written as negation P or Q. So negation P or what is your Q here? Q and R. You apply the De Morgan. You don't have any conditional or biconditional statements now. So you can apply the De Morgan's law. Now it becomes negation of negation P or becomes and negation of this whole term. So it becomes negation of negation P will be equal to P and negation Q or negation R, right? So why? Because between the terms you should have a sum, but here you have an AND operation. So that is the reason I'll apply the distributive law. Therefore, it becomes P and negation Q, or this R operation I am distributing, or P and negation R. So when you observe here, this is one term and the second term. Between the two terms, you have a sum, and between the variables in each term, you have an AND. So these two are the elementary products, and between the elementary products, you have a sum. Therefore, this is in the form of sum of elementary products. Therefore, it is in DNF form. Is it clear? Yes, see the next example. P and negation of Q or R or this term. So get a DNF form for this. So here you don't have any conditional biconditional statements. Therefore, you can apply the distributive law as well as the De Morgan's law. So in the first term, you can apply the De Morgan's law, right? Now it becomes P, and when you apply the De Morgan's law on this, it becomes negation Q and negation R. Or, so here you can apply the distributive law. You can apply the distributive law. Treat this as one term, P and Q as one term, and this as second term. So second variable. treat this P and Q as one variable and this negation R as one variable. So you can apply the distributive law here. Why? Because here within the parenthesis and outside the parenthesis you have a different symbol. Now it becomes P and Q and P, or this R we are distributing. Now we are distributing this R symbol, negation R and P. So you just simplify this again. Now it becomes P and negation Q and R. This is one term, and within the term and between each variable you have an AND symbol. So this is one elementary product, or so it is something like P and Q or negation, sorry, P and negation R, right? So this is one term. Here also you have a product symbol, so this is one elementary product. And here also you have a product symbol, so this is also one elementary product. So between all the elementary products, you have a sum. It is in sum of elementary products. Right? So you take this second, this example. All of you take this next example. That is P and P tends to Q. You please get a DNF for this. Take this example and try to convert it into DNF. Did everyone of you understand? Now solve this one. Can you able to do? Thank you.
So did anyone of you solve this, ma'am? Okay. So let me explain now. Only two steps. P and you convert this conditional statement. Now it becomes negation P or Q. So apply the distributive law, because you cannot apply the De Morgan's law here. Now it becomes P and negation P or P and Q. So you can all, if you want, you can simplify this. Now what you will get when you simplify this, the result will be F, because it is an AND symbol. F or something is what? That something is what? P and Q. That means you will get only one elementary product. If you have more than one elementary products, between the elementary products, you should have an element, sorry, sum, right? So if you want, you can leave it like this, just to show that it is in DNF, or else if you want, you can simplify this, right? Now, take the next example and try to solve this one. P tends to Q, and take this next example. So P tends to Q and negation of negation Q and P. So take this example and solve. Get disjunctive normal form. The procedure is same. First eliminate conditional and biconditional statement. After that apply De Morgan's law and distributive law. Yes, ma'am, finish. Did every one of you solve that? Six J. You please show me. 6J. Turn on your camera and show me. Are you there? 6J. If you don't respond, I'll not give you attendance, ma. You please turn on your camera first. I'll mark absent for you 6J. Next 6A. 6A. One second. Take down the question first. The question is the one which I have highlighted. Is it okay? Surya Teja. Now tell me ma, 6A. Turn on your camera. Six A. For you also I'll mark absent. 6M. Can you show me what you did? 6M. What happened to you? Why you people are not responding? 6A, 6J, 6M. Are you there in the class or not? Then you send me a picture. 6M, you send me a photo. 6R. See this one. See. So here first what you need to do, first you need to eliminate the conditional statement, right? So write this P tends to Q as negation P or Q. On the first term, first term is written like this. Next. Here on the second term, you can apply the De Morgan's law, then it becomes Q and P, right? So now this is your PQ and this is your P. P tends to Q can be written as negation P or the whole Q term. Negation P or Q, right? Yes. Sorry. I have already explained this, I think, right? Yes, Masurya Teja. I have already explained this. So please go, let us go through the next example. P double tends to Q. So first what you need to do, this biconditional statement should be converted into P tends to Q and Q tends to P. P tends to Q and Q tends to P. Now this conditional statement can be eliminated or removed by using the formula negation P or Q. Negation P or Q, and this can be written as negation Q or P. Now you can apply the distributive law. So you will get four terms. Negation P and negation Q. 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2. Like that four terms you will get. And these are, we are distributing, right? Now you will get negation P and P. This is 1, 1. This is 1, 2. This is 2, 1. That is Q negation Q. 2, 2 is Q, P. So after you simplify this, you will get this. Okay? So like this, whenever you are asked to convert a preposition, given preposition, into a equivalent DNA form, so what you need to do is you need to first eliminate the conditional and biconditional statements. After that, you can apply the De Morgan's law and distributive law. So at the end, you should get your answer in the form of sum of elementary products. That is your DNA form. Next is CNF, conjunctive normal forms. CNF is this, the opposite for DNF. That means that is DNF is sum of elementary products. This is the CNF is product of elementary sum. Just opposite for DNF is your CNF, product of elementary sum. Let us see one example. So consider the given preposition as negation P. Negation of P or Q double tends to P and Q, right? So here you have a biconditional statement. First, you need to eliminate this biconditional statement. How to eliminate this? P double tends to Q can be written as P tends to Q and Q tends to P. You can apply the same formula here where this is, this complete one is your P and this complete term is your Q. Negation of P or Q is your P. P and Q is your Q, right? Just apply the same formula here. P tends to Q. That is negation of P or Q tends to, what is my Q here? P and Q. And Q tends to P. Just reverse of this. P and Q tends to negation of P or Q. Right? Now again, now one more time you have a conditional statement here. So you remove this using the formula negation P or Q. What is your P here? Your P is this complete term. And what is your Q? P and Q is your Q. Right? So apply the formula negation P or Q. Whenever. So when you apply this negation of this P, first term or Q. And same formula you can apply here, negation P or Q. Now you apply the De Morgan's law here. Negation of negation, it will get cancelled. So left over is P or Q or P and Q. So here also you apply the De Morgan's law, then it becomes negation P or negation Q. Here it becomes negation P and negation Q. Right? So when you apply the distributive law here, so P or Q or this P, distribute this Q and operation. So now it becomes P or Q. This is first term and this is the second variable in the second term. First variable in the first term. Right? Now same form that you apply here, apply the distributive law, distribute this AND operation. Distribute this AND operation. Then you will get first term and this first variable. First term and the second variable. Right? Negation P or negation Q or negation P. Negation P or negation Q or negation Q. Now you simplify this one. This can be written as P or Q. This can also be written as P or Q. Now it can be written as negation P or negation Q. This also can be written as negation P or negation Q. Right? So instead of these two, we have two variables here. Same P or Q. Two times your it is repeating. Therefore, you can consider only one time. Now P or Q and this remaining terms. So here also negation P or negation Q. It is repeating for two times. So you can consider only one time, negation P or negation Q you can consider one time, P or Q also you can consider one time. Now between the terms you have a sum, and within the term, between the variables you have a, sorry, between the terms you have a product, within the term you have a sum. It is product of sums, product of sums. Product of sums means what? It is in CNF, conjunctive normal forms. Go through this example once. We'll see one more example later. First, go through this example. Yes, ma. Did you all understand? Did everyone of you understand what I explained now? See one more example. You are P and R, and negation of negation is to this whole term P or R and Q. Convert it into CNF. You can, you don't have any conditional biconditional statements here. Here on the second term you can apply the De Morgan's law. So first term will be as it is only. Now you can apply the distributive, sorry, De Morgan's law. Now it becomes negation of the first term or negation Q. Write down. Now apply the distributive law on the first term here. So it becomes Q or P. This AND operation I am distributing Q or R. And here it can apply the associative law. A plus B plus C can be written as A plus B plus C. Here you again have this negation outside this parenthesis. So you can apply the distributive law. Now it becomes negation P and negation R. Or now you can apply the distributive law. So these two terms you got from this first term. From this first term you got two terms. Similarly from this also you will get more two terms. Right? So negation P and negation Q. Negation P or negation Q, and distribute this R operation, then you will get negation R or negation Q. So when you observe this, between the terms, what symbol you are having? You are a product symbol. Between the terms, you have a product. Sorry, ma, this is R symbol. I have written it mistakenly. By mistake, I have written it as AND, but this is R. So it is P or Q. So between each term, you have a product, and within the term, you have a sum. That means it is product of elementary sum. This is sum. This is R operation. By mistake, I have written it like this. So now it is in CNF form. Now, so whenever you are asked to convert a preposition into a DNF or CNF, you don't think that every preposition will have a unique CNF and a unique DNF. Say, for one preposition, you may get more than one equivalent DNF and CNF. Right? So if you get one answer and if your friend get one more answer, you don't get, you don't think that you are wrong or your friend is wrong. Right? So if it is in DNF or if it is in CNF form, if the form is correct and if you have applied the formulas in its correct sequence, then they are same only. Your answer will be correct. So next, you know that whenever a compound preposition is given, how to prove that it is a tautology? Tautology means what? Tautology means it is giving you all the true values for all the combination of the truth values, right? So after simplifying at the end, if you are able to get your answer as T, then you can say that the given preposition is a tautology. See here, ma. See this example. So this is the given compound preposition, right? So now on these two terms, you can apply the distributive law. Why? Because these two symbols are different. So when you apply the distributive law, it becomes P or negation P, and distribute this R operation, sorry, AND operation. Now negation Q or negation Q, you can also write it as a single negation Q. Now simplify this, ma. you are the first term and you just apply this q to the each and every terms within the parenthesis, then you will get q are the first term, q are the second term. So q are negation q, the result is what? It is always true only. Similarly from here, p or negation q is true, true or something is always true. Now true and true, true and true is always true. So the given preposition is a tautology. In your examination, if you are asked to prove that given preposition is a tautology without using the truth table, then you have to apply these equivalences formulas. Clear for everyone? Next concept is rules of inference. So, rules of inference is whenever you are given with some premises or when you are given with some prepositions, from the given prepositions, if you are able to derive a given conclusion, then it is known as inference theory. It is known as an inference theory. That means, from given prepositions, sometimes you can also use the word premises in place of prepositions. Here we will use the word premises, or sometimes you will use the word hypothesis. Hypothesis or premises or prepositions we will use here. Right? So from the given premises, from the given set of premises, if a conclusion is derived, then that process is known as deduction. It is also known as formal proof. And whatever the conclusion you are deriving, that conclusion is known as a valid argument, also known as a valid conclusion. Clear? So you are given with set of premises, and from the set of premises, you have to prove that conclusion can be derived. That conclusion is known as a valid argument. Right? So this process, ప్రాయం అంటే పిల్లగాడు పడుతున్న ప్రాయం అంటే ఎవరు నేను ఫోన్ చూడమండి, ఇయర్ ఫోన్స్ పెట్టుకొని ఫోన్ చూస్తున్నా, లిమిట్స్ క్రాస్గా మాకు మషాలు అవుతున్నాయి బాగా. So this can be done in two ways. First method is by using the truth table method, second without using the truth table. First we'll see how to prove that a conclusion is a valid conclusion. That means how to prove that a conclusion can be derived from the set of premises. Right? So first see this truth table method. Now, in this truth table method, what you will do is assume that H1, H2, H3 are the given hypotheses. That means H1, H2, H3, so on up to other given prepositions. Prepositions were given, and the variables within the prepositions are assumed that they are P1 to PN. Something like if you have P or Q, that is one premises or that is one hypothesis. In that P and Q, we have the variables, no? Those are known as the variables within the premises, right? So P1 to PN are the variables in a given premises H1 to H1. Now the conclusion is C, right? So you need to prove that this conclusion C can be derived from this set of given premises, right? Now whenever you are using this truth table method, first what you have to do is, first you need to construct the truth table. First you need to construct the truth table for all the given premises. For all the given premises, the truth table is to be constructed. 1 hour, you sit and write. Now, after constructing the truth tables, look for, we use, whenever you are using this truth table method,
you can use two rules. You can either use this first rule to prove that conclusion can be derived, or you can use this second rule. I'll explain the both. Whichever is comfortable for you, you can use that. So first rule is, look for the rows where the hypothesis, wherever, where these given premises are having the true value. You first see the rule here. After that, I'll explain with example. So first, construct the truth table for the set of premises. After constructing the truth table, look for the rows where all these given premises are having a true value. Now, in every such row, this every is important, ma. For every row, the condition is to be satisfied. What is that condition? The conclusion C should also have the true value. Then we can say that C is derived from H1 to HM. Is it clear? First, construct the truth table. Next, after that, look for the rows where, for which premises this row, this truth value is true. For which given premises we have a true value. Next, in every such row, if the conclusion is also having the same true value, then it is a valid conclusion or a valid argument, right? Now, second rule is, you can also use the second rule, which is a false condition. Look for the rows in which conclusion is false. Conclusion is false. Now, in every such row, at least one. So, every row is important, but in every row, if at least one of the hypothesis value is false, then we can say that conclusion is a valid conclusion, right? So, what is this false condition? In case of true condition, we are checking the hypothesis rows first. After that, you are checking the conclusion. But in case of this false condition, first you are checking for the row where the conclusion value is false. In every such row, if at least one of the hypothesis value is false, then it is a valid argument, right? So please go through this once, ma. Go through these two rules once. Is there anyone who did not understand any one of these rules? Did you all understand the rules? Then we can move on to the examples. Yes, okay. Let's move on to one example. Determine whether the conclusion C follows from the hypothesis given. Now, what are those hypotheses? See, first example is H1 is given as P tends to Q. H2 is given as P and the conclusion is given as C. H1, H2 are given, and from H1 and H2, C, that is capital Q, is to be derived. Right? Similarly, second example is same H1 is same, H2 is Q and the conclusion is P. Like the five problems were given. So in all the five problems, what I'm doing is, as we have only few terms in all these five examples. So I'm going to construct a truth table for all the five examples together. First, identify what is required for all the five problems. How many variables were present? P and Q are the two variables present. Next, you require P tends to Q. And here you require negation P. And you require P double tends to Q. And you also require negation. Yeah, actually, you don't require negation Q actually. And negation of P and Q is required. Right? So these are the terms required in all the example. So first construct the truth table for all these marks. First construct the truth table. Right? Now you know how to construct the truth table. And say in case of conditional statement, if this is your hypothesis. The first one is your hypothesis. The second one is conclusion. Right? If wherever the only the conclusion is false, in that case the result will be false. In case of double tends to, that is biconditional, when both the values are same, that can be either true or false. When both the values are same, in that case, the result is true. In all other cases, the result will be false. So, in the first case as well as in the fourth case, the result will be true. In the remaining cases, the result is false, right? Now, see the first example. So, in the first example, H1 is P tends to Q. P tends to Q is H1 and P is H2. What is the conclusion? This is your conclusion. Right? H1 and H2. Now see the rules now. Let us assume that we are following the first rule. So in the first rule, what you have to do? Look for the rows where all the hypotheses have, wherever the hypothesis is having the true value. In every such row, if C is also having the true value, then it is valid, right? So, what are hypotheses here? This is one hypothesis, this is one hypothesis. Now, look for the rows where H1, H2 are having true values. So, this is one such row. H1 and H2 are having true values. But here, H2 is having a false value. Here, H1 is having a false value. And here, H1 is having false value. So, only in the first row, you have the hypothesis with the true value. Now, in every such row, but here you have only one row. If you have more than one row, for every such row, what you have to do? Check whether the conclusion is also having the true value or not. If the conclusion is also having the true value for every such row, then we can say that the conclusion is a valid conclusion. We can derive this conclusion from these two hypotheses. From the first H1 and H2 hypothesis. Right? Second rule is what? False condition. False condition is what? Look for the rows where conclusion is false. In every such row, if at least one value of H1 to H1 is false. Right? Now, look for the rows. This is your conclusion, right? So, look for the rows where conclusion is false. So, such rows are two. We have two such rows. Now, in every of that row, if at least one of H1 and H2 is false, at least one of H1 and H2 is false, then the conclusion is a valid conclusion. So, here you have false. Here also you have one hypothesis value as what? Right? So, using both the rules, you can prove that, you can say that the given conclusion is a valid conclusion from the given hypothesis. Right? Now, see the second example. So, in the second example, your H1 is P tends to Q and H2 is Q. H1 is P tends to Q, H2 is Q. Right? Now, conclusion is P. P tends to Q, Q. That is, this is your H1, this is your H2, and this is your conclusion. Conclusion. Now, see this mark. So, first rule I am following. Look for the rows. Look for the rows where H1 to H1 are true. Look for the rows where H1, H2 are true. So, we have two such rows. In every such row, if the conclusion is also true, so this condition should be satisfied for every such row. But here, for this row, the condition is not true. Why? Because the conclusion is false here. So, therefore we can say that conclusion is not valid. It is the given conclusion cannot be derived from the given set of premises. Is it clear for you all? Now see the third example, where H1 is negation P, H2 is P double tends to Q, and this is your conclusion. So this is your H1, H2 and conclusion. Look for the rows where H1, H2 are true. So this is not the row. So look for the rows where H1, H2 are true. So here you have false and false. So true and false. Look for the rows where H1 and H2 are true. Now for every such row, if you have your conclusion with true value, if you have a conclusion with true value, then we can say that it is a valid conclusion. Here the condition is satisfied, so it is a valid conclusion. Clear? Now see for the fourth example, in the fourth example, H1 is P tends to Q. This is your H1. Negation P is your H2. And Q is your conclusion. So, look for the rows. Look for the rows where H1 and H2 are true. Look for the rows where H1 and H2 are true. So, we have two such rows. For every such row, if the conclusion is also true, for every such row, if the conclusion is also true, then conclusion is a valid. But here, for the fourth row, the condition is false. So, it is not a valid condition, not a valid conclusion. Conclusion is not valid. Now, see the last example. H1 is P tends to Q, H2 is negation of P and Q, conclusion is negation P. Look for the rows where H1, H2 are true. Look for the rows where H1, H2 are true. So, we have two such rows. Now, in every such row, if the conclusion is also true, then it is a valid conclusion. The conclusion is a valid conclusion. Clear? So, did every one of you understand this, ma? So, did every one of you understand this? How to prove that a conclusion is a valid conclusion from a given set of premises? So, did every one of you understand, ma? Okay. So, now you take this example, ma. Let me explain this one also. I'll give you one more example for you. So in the second problem, so see this here, one conclusion is given and one hypothesis is given and one conclusion is given, right? So first construct the truth table for hypothesis and conclusions, okay? So construct the truth table for the first problem. When you construct this truth table, what is required? P, Q, P tends to Q, P and Q, P tends to P and Q, right? Now, go through the problem. First, what you need to check, look for the rows where hypothesis is having a true value. So this is your hypothesis, right? So only one hypothesis is given. So look for the rows where this hypothesis value is true. Now, in every such row, if the conclusion is also true, then it is a valid conclusion. Yes, the condition is satisfied. So it is a valid conclusion. The conclusion follows from the given set of hypotheses. Now, see the second example. In the second example, H1 is negation P. Negation P is your H1. P or Q. P or Q is your H2. And what is your conclusion? Capital Q. So this Q is your conclusion, right? So look for the rows where H1 and H2 are having the true values. Here you have only one such row. In every of that row, if the conclusion is also having same true value, then it is a valid conclusion. Yes, the condition is satisfied. Now go through the last problem. Negation P or Q, that is your H1. Negation P or Q is your H1. Negation of Q and negation R is your H2. Negation of Q and R, negation R is your H2. And H3 is also given, that is negation R. H3 is negation R. Now, what is this conclusion? Negation P is your conclusion, right? So this is your conclusion, right? Now here you have three variables P, Q, R. So total of eight truth value combinations you will get, right? You know how to write all the eight truth value. So if the variables are only two, you will get four combinations like T, 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 F, F, T and F, F, right? So for all these four combinations, you put a T before this, then you will get four combination. If you put F before the four combination, you will get more four combination. Like that, you will get total of eight combinations. Total of eight combinations you will get, right? Now, this is your H1, H2 and H3. And this is your conclusion. Look for the rows where H1, H2, H3 are true. So here we have a false. So this is not such row. T, T, F. So this row also you cannot consider. Here also you cannot consider this row. Now this is T, F. One false value is there, you cannot consider. Here also one false value. And this is also one false value, you cannot consider. This row also you cannot consider because this is false value. So you can consider the last row. Why? Because this is true, true, true. All the hypothesis values are true. So you can consider this row. Now, in every such row, if the conclusion is also true, therefore we can say that it is a valid conclusion. The conclusion is derived from the given set of premises. So did you all understand, ma? If yes, I'll give you one example problem. Now you take down this example. Take the first three examples. Take the first three examples and you solve it. Using the truth table, you solve first three examples. Now the time is 4:53. I'll ask you at 5:10. I'll ask you at 5:10. 15 minutes of time I gave you. and you have to solve all the three problems. Then you have to show me one. Take the first two problems. In the next class, I'll explain how to prove without using the truth table. Yes, ma'am. Any one of you solve this problem? Finish. Seven K. At what time you are joining the class? 79. Can you show me your book? 79. Unmute and explain, ma. Rule number. Okay, ma. Okay. Sixty-eight. Show me your book. It's not clear, ma. Okay. Okay. So every one of you understand this rules of inference, right? How to prove that a conclusion is valid using the truth table method, right? Now second method is without using the truth table method. So in this process, you have to remember two rules. One is rule P and the second one is rule T. Rule P means a premise or a hypothesis can be introduced at any point in the derivation. You will be given with set of premises, right? So, in the set of premises, you can consider any premise based on our requirement at any point of time while you are doing your derivation. That is known as rule P. When you have introduced a new hypothesis or new premise, then you can say that it is a rule P. Second one is rule T. Rule T means a formula may be introduced in the derivation. In case of rule P, you are introducing a premise, but in case of rule T, you are introducing a formula. Right? So if that formula S is a tautology, is tautology, if it is a tautological implied by any one or more of more formulas in the preceding formulas. Right? So, one second. So a formula S can be introduced in the derivation when that formula is tautologically implied by one or more of the given premises. Okay? So we'll see how to apply these two rules when you are deriving. As of now, what you need to remember is rule P means you can introduce a premise at any point in the derivation. Rule T means you can introduce a formula which is logically equivalent to the premises what you have, which is logically equivalent. So along with these two rules, you should know some implications as well as some equivalences which you can apply in the derivation process. First, to see some implications. Right? So we have some 14 implications. So first one is P can be implied from P and Q, and Q also can be implied from P and Q. So from P and Q, P is implied. Similarly, Q can also be implied. These implications are known as simplification. Similarly, P or Q can be implied from P, and from P or Q can be implied from Q. It is known as addition. Now, P tends to Q can be implied from negation P. And P tends to Q can be implied from Q. Right? So it is something like P tends to Q. You can write it as negation P or negation Q. Right? So therefore you can say that negation P can be implied from P. P tends to Q can be implied from negation P. And it can also be implied from Q. So here also when you have P and Q, when you are using this addition operation, that is OR operation, you can write it as P or Q. Right? So you can say that P or Q can be implied from P, and P or Q can also be implied from Q. Right? Next formula is P can be implied from negation of P tends to Q. It is the reverse of the fifth and sixth implications one. Reverse of 5-6 implications, you will get 7-8 implications, right? So P can be implied from negation of P tends to Q. Similarly, when you have P tends to Q, you will get negation P. When you have negation of P tends to Q, you will get P. Now, negation Q can be implied from negation of P tends to Q. Similarly, P and Q can be implied from P, comma Q. And Q can be implied from negation P and P or Q. So it is known as disjunctive syllogism. Something like negation P or P or Q. It means what? Negation P or P. One second. see these implications once. We'll be applying these implications and equivalences, ma'am, in the derivation process. So this is disjunctive syllogism means negation P or P or Q, it is equal to Q. Similarly, modus ponens, these two are very important. Modus ponens, modus tollens, these two are very important, ma'am. So Q is implied from P and P tends to Q. Q is implied from P and P tends to Q. And modus ponens, that is modus ponens. Next one is modus tollens. Modus tollens means negation P is implied from negation Q and P tends to Q. And P tends to Q. Next, hypothetical syllogism means P tends to Q, Q tends to R. From these two, you can derive P tends to R. Similarly, dilemma, the last one is dilemma. So, from these two, P tends to R, Q tends to R. From these, you can derive P tends to Q. And the next one is P or Q. You have one more syllogism, one more hypothesis, that is P or Q. Right? So, from all these three syllogisms together, you can derive a single R. Single R. So, you have to remember all these implications. Along with these implications, we'll see more equivalences also. First, see these implications once. In the next class, I'll explain. In the next class, I'll explain equivalences. So, see these implications once. So, did every one of you understand what I explained in today's class? So, any one of you having doubts? Okay, ma'am. Wait for some time. I'll take the attendance.